Lecture 3. This is the third lecture on what I have called medicine. I hope to explore things that I have found of interest as a student of mysticism practically involved in the occupation of medicine. I've divided the topics of interest into 12 sections and will be speaking through each of them as we go along. The metaphysics-medicine interface. I have used the model of Maslow's hierarchy of needs to explain this. We start with biological and psychological needs through to safety needs, belongingness and love needs, esteem needs, cognitive needs, aesthetic needs, and at the top of the tree, self-actualization needs. Mysticism, meditation, and metaphysics deals with the very top end of this tree, i.e. self-actualization. And conventional medicine is concerned with the first level, i.e. biological and psychological needs. People visit doctors when they are ill, and the moment they start to recover, they cease to be of medical concern. So the metaphysics-medicine interface is everything in between levels 1 to 7 of the model. Is orthodox medicine holistic? There is often a perception that orthodox practitioners are not holistic. They just deal with bits of people, unlike complementary therapists who deal, as it were, with the whole person. This is actually quite untrue. Orthodox practitioners do deal with the whole person as best they know how. For people like me who have worked in general practice, every person that sits in front of me is looked at from a psychological point of view, from their social needs point of view, and their physical point of view. So, orthodox medicine is holistic. Obviously, practitioners in hospitals are tasked to particularly deal with specific things and refer matters back to the general practitioner that looks after the whole person. There is a concept of division of the person into mind, body, and soul. Now, in conventional medicine, yes, we do mind, we do body, we don't do spirit. The complementary alternative medicine and orthodox medicine divide. Over the last 25 years, because of my involvement with meditation groups and of similar groups, I have met a lot of people that were training to be healers and alternative practitioners. These complementary therapies are very popular with patients, and I've often been asked why it has not been integrated into orthodox medicine. And the answer to that is that it is actually very difficult. As far as UK GPs are concerned, they are not insured to deal with complementary therapists, and the current spiraling workload really deters interest in anything else. Also, there is no funding for this, and certainly for the foreseeable future, there is not going to be much change in this area. Interestingly enough, there was a lot of interest between 1995 and 2005 in complementary therapies, and lots of articles appeared in the normal medical press about it. But after 2005, for some reason, there have been few and far between. Spiritual perspectives in orthodox medicine. I tried to think about this and actually discovered that there are none. I thought about my own journey through medicine from 1974 to the present day, and I cannot recall having any kind of medical discussion or even hearing doctors speaking among themselves about things that concern so-called spiritual topics. And things like the word spirit, soul, religion, spiritual healing, religious notions of different kinds, prayer, meaning of life, are just taboo subjects and are not discussed. This may be a good thing, because as doctors say, we are doctors, not priests or philosophers. Talking therapies. Now, when a patient attends a doctor, they present either with a physical problem, a psychological distress, or some sort of mixture of both. Now, physical problems are straightforward. You can have a pain in the chest, a pain in the head, a pain in the knee, foot, or some sort of digestive problem, or whatever. That is straightforward and dealt with in the normal way. When it comes to a psychological distress, a doctor within the first 10 minutes of consultation is able to distinguish between anything that is severe, like a psychotic illness or a very serious depression and anxiety, which tends to get almost straight away referred to hospital medicine to be dealt with. A lot of the everyday anxiety and depression that come to general practitioners is dealt with within primary care or general practice and doesn't go beyond that. Now, in the case of managing psychological distress like anxiety or depression, there are really two basic avenues. One is some kind of talk therapy, and that talk being provided by either the doctor himself, some sort of counselor or therapist, a social worker, or a psychiatric nurse. The second avenue is prescribing some sort of medication, which might be an antidepressant, a sleeping tablet for a short period of time, an anti-anxiety medication. Now, as far as talking to patients is concerned, any kind of religious-oriented talk is strictly forbidden. I'm going to go through 7 or 8 interesting things that I have come across. These have not appeared in the field of conventional medicine, but they have appeared in the general area and are really interesting to me. The first is emotional intelligence. This was Daniel Goleman in the 1970s. Emotional intelligence refers to a person's ability to understand their own emotions and those of others. And what is now believed is that this can matter even more than IQ, and that some of the skills can be learned. And in fact, this is very relevant to any kind of team situation where people have to work together. The second interesting study is neuroplasticity. And this was the work of Dr. Richard Davidson, a scientist from the United States, who in 2005 presented his research on the effects of meditation on the brain. Time magazine nominated him as one of the 100 most influential people of the last century, so this work was considered as very important. Dr. Davidson appears to have teamed up with the Dalai Lama, and he was able to access the cooperation of chosen, accomplished Buddhist monks with 15 to 40 years of practice behind them, which represented literally between 10,000 and 50,000 hours of meditation practice. These monks, at will, can put themselves into a different kind of state, and the electrical activity of the brain and blood flow through the brain was studied using methods such as electrophysiology, positron emission scanning, MRI scanning, and so forth. The result of this study was that a new map appeared. There was a possibility of mapping out parts of the brain where particular things happened, and it showed how they seemed to happen as far as people that were practicing meditation. What was shown here was, it was suggested that the brain could actually change. It was previously thought that neurons were fixed and there was no possibility of real change of growth, but this study proved otherwise. The third study has to do with happiness research. This is the work of Dr. Martin Seligman, who in 1998 was elected as president of the American Psychological Association. Now, in the early 2000s, they began to study happiness. all sorts of different studies and work that had been done were on people that were sad or depressed and so forth. But there was not much research being done on what made people feel happy and full of gusto. So they began a scientific study to try and understand this. And the result of this work was published by Dr. Seligman in his book, Authentic Happiness. Time magazine published a leading article in their 7th February 2005 edition called The Biology of Joy, which looked at all the results of this research into happiness. And this article is really interesting to read. The next study is about the faith gene. I came across this again in the Time magazine article of 29th November 2004. The article was called The God Gene, and this referred to the work of biologist Dr. Dean Hammer, working at the National Cancer Institute in America. His work appeared to show that if people possess a gene called VMAT2, this will predispose a person to believe in some sort of higher power. And the question arose, is faith hardwired in people's genes? Dr. Hammer was clear to point out that this did not prove any kind of existence of God. He just pointed to the fact that if you had this gene, you were likely to believe in some sort of higher power, and that was all. Also in this Time magazine article, there was a quiz, a personal inventory of 20 questions with the title, How Spiritual Are You? This article was very interesting, and I certainly found I scored very high on this. The fifth study refers to the chemistry of emotions. This is the work of Dr. Candace Pert, who was a research professor in physiology and biophysics, and one of the neuroscientists that discovered endorphins and opiate receptors in the brain. Her work was really to discover the chemistry associated with psychological states, in particular mystical states, or states where people experienced highs, as it were. She did produce a book, Why You Feel the Way You Feel, and I think it's quite possible that in fact, the basis of all things is chemical, and as it is sometimes put, we are a bunch of chemicals running around in a bag. The sixth study I'll talk about is the work of Abraham Maslow. His work was really phenomenal. He was a motivational psychologist, and he published a book called Motivation and Personality in 1954. And his work, The Hierarchy of Needs, is still in current use. He stated 5 needs as a hierarchy, which are displayed here on the slide and can be found in all the literature. Later on, this was amended to make 5 into 7 needs. Quite interestingly as well, I came across the work of Wayne Dyer, a well-known American New Age guru, who brought out a DVD called From Ambition to Meaning. And he seemed to suggest that the first early part of our life is devoted to ambition. In other words, making something of ourselves, making a career for ourselves, raising a family and so forth. But the second part of our life is really all about finding meaning. And if there was a difficulty in moving from ambition to meaning, then this would create a situation in life which would need wise resolution or a way of looking at it. In this connection, I remember the standard Vedic stages of life, which were that of a celibate student, a householder, the stage of spiritual search, and a sannyasi. I'd like to speak a little about this because this is part of the ancient Vedic literature, and it would seem, from what I know, that communities in India in some instances still kept to this system until about 150 years ago, at which time it probably vanished completely. The first state was called brahmachari when a young man was a student or in the first stages of life. He then became a grahasth, a householder. This was about marriage and raising a family. The third part of his life was called vanaprasharam. This presumably was when the children had flown the nest and a man and his wife, as it were, would try and give up the world and go in search for God. The fourth state, called sannyasi, was really the state of renouncing, where a person was preparing to meet their maker. The seventh study I'd like to talk about is transactional analysis. This is Eric Byrne's work of the 1970s. Transactional analysis is considered to be one of the most accessible theories of modern psychology. Byrne basically said that people operate from three kinds of ego states, which were the parent, the adult, and the child. There's a lot of literature about this, and I won't go into this in detail. But the parent here represented a thought concept. The adult represented a thought concept, i.e. what you think. And the child represented a felt concept, what you feel. Certainly in medicine, in trying to understand when consultations go wrong, this model is often accessed in order to try and understand. For instance, if a patient comes to the doctor and says, "I've had this back pain for 10 years, and what are you going to do about it?" This suggests to the doctor that the patient is like a child looking to him like a parent. The work here is to bring each to an adult state so the doctor and patient may converse about the matter. You have an opposite situation where the patient says, "Well, look, doctor, I know you're very busy, and I know what's wrong with me. I know what I need. If you just give me this prescription, I'll be out of your door in 5 minutes. So one is presented with a fait accompli. This is a case of the patient acting as a parent and treating the doctor as a child. Out of transactional analysis came certain aspects of human communication. For example, words are not as important as they are made out to be, and in fact people are more interested in how things are said as opposed to what is said, and people may not remember what is said, and things like facial expressions are very important. The last study I'd like to touch on is Rogerian counseling. Carl Rogers, who lived in the last century, 1902 to 1987, is considered to be one of the great founding fathers of modern counseling, and he developed what is called client-centered counseling. This involved the ability of the therapist to put himself in the shoes of the client and see the world through the client's eyes. This required a particular inner attitude of therapist and a particular way of behaving with the client. One of the key things was listening skills, and this applies to all cases where therapists or doctors meet patients or clients. For a client, it's important that the therapist not only listens to them, but they need to feel that the therapist is listening to them. And for this, there are certain specific skills that Rogers brought to bear. Rogers also said that the therapist had to be real, and by real, he meant that they shouldn't give double messages. In other words, if they were not comfortable in talking about a particular topic that the client had brought up, they should say so. So this required an emotional clarity on the therapist's part, and the therapist also had to evoke in a client what's called positive unconditional regard, so that a client could feel that they were being listened to and treated with non-possessive warmth. and that the client felt valued and supported. So, all these studies have certainly shown me that life's very much about how we feel. Mind-body medicine. One gets traditions like hypnotherapy, yoga, tai chi, qigong, biofeedback training, meditation. And there's no doubt that all these things can help with anxiety and stress problems, psychosomatic problems, because they put one in touch with the subtle physical and emotional energies of life, and they are certainly a valuable adjunct to other therapy. Movement as therapy. This centers around the work of Wilhelm Reich, who was a pupil of Freud, but went on to develop particular views on the way people held types of muscle tensions in their body, which he called armoring. So people had posture and muscle tension patterns, and these were associated with specific emotions unique to them. Wilhelm developed a therapy based upon breathing and relaxation exercises. In the 1970s, a gentleman called Alexander Lowen started bioenergetics. He improved upon Reich's theories and insights, and he too developed a series of exercises for the body to help with emotional problems. Now, going back to lecture one, I spoke about the connection between habitual thoughts, habitual feelings, and habitual patterns of muscular tension, which are linked. So unless one works on patterns of muscular tension, one is hamstrung to deal with one's habitual thoughts or habitual feelings. As far as medicine or medical practice is concerned, dance, swimming, exercise posture techniques, and physical training programs will help with emotional problems. And there's a very simple way to understand this. Imagine when one is depressed, one tends to lean hunched forward with the head hung down and so forth. Try to straighten yourself up, throw your head back, shoulders back, and see if you can feel the feeling in the same way. One can't. This is a very simple understanding of it. Mindfulness techniques in therapy. The use of Buddhist meditation techniques have been developed for use in medical practice by John Kabat-Zinn from the Massachusetts Medical School, who since 1979 has used mindfulness techniques in medical settings. It's quite simple. If you recall what I said in lecture one, our consciousness is based on past, present, and future. Now, whereas a happy person may have very happy memories of the past and may look forward to the future with enthusiasm and gusto, a person with mental health problems will often remember the past with a great deal of sadness, and when they look at the future, they feel great fear and trepidation. So the use of mindfulness techniques and developing a sense of the personal here and now, now breathing, now living, and now sensing, immediately helps with that problem and starts to reprogram the mind to think and feel in a different way. And this, without doubt, is an adjunct to the treatment of anxiety and mild depression. Very interestingly, the NICE guidelines in the United Kingdom that came out in October 2009 actually mentioned the word mindfulness, cognitive behavioral therapy, for the first time. And this has entered conventional medical literature now. People from conventional settings are now being sent to train in these techniques. Transpersonal approaches to therapy and psychotherapy. Now the word transpersonal refers to beyond the person. There's no one type of transpersonal therapy, but it refers to a variety of therapies that are outside the medical box. In real life, one finds people that help others with various kinds of problems. They could be healers, they could be mediums, they could be Reiki practitioners, people with New Age ideas, astrologers, religious counselors of different kinds, hypnotherapists, timeline hypnotherapists, past life therapists, and so on. But all these are outside the medical box, and no doctor working within the system gets directly involved with them. But patients have found them very useful. Now, the unconscious in therapy. Sigmund Freud was considered one of the most famous people of the last century because he developed this concept of the unconscious. In other words, what we know to be conscious is kind of a tip of an iceberg, and below that is something that he called the unconscious. I'm very briefly going to talk about five people that have theories and an understanding in certain aspects of the unconscious that I have found of interest. The work of Freud, the work of Jung, the work of Roberto Assagioli, the work of Brian Weiss, and I will say a little bit about what I personally believe to do with meditation practice and the unconscious. There's a very useful diagram of understanding the concept of the unconscious if one goes into Google and types the word Jung, J-U-N-G. It has been illustrated to suit the purpose of this lecture. Now imagine that one is flying over an ocean and one sees a group of islands in the sea. A cluster of five dots is shown in the diagram. These represent islands that are above the waterline. Now if you look at an island in a kind of cross-sectional way, you get a part that is above the water, a part that is below the water, and a part that is the seabed. So if you think of the part that is above the water as your personal unconscious, and the part that is below the water but above the seabed as your personal unconscious, and the seabed is really the collective unconscious. Now I'm going to use this little diagram to explain what's to follow. Psychoanalysis by Sigmund Freud. Now Freud regarded the unconscious as a kind of repository of traumatic events and repressed infantile fantasies. Jung, on the other hand, who was Freud's famous pupil, initially agreed with Freud, but later went on to develop his own theories of the unconscious, and a great deal of literature is available on this subject. In the unconscious, as Jung saw it, he described that it was actually a history of the human species and cosmic order, which formed what he called the collective unconscious. There are many terms such as individuation, animus, anima, archetypes, and so forth, which are well described in the standard literature. So Jung was the first person to see the unconscious in transpersonal terms. Psychosynthesis. This refers to the work of Roberto Assagioli. Now he was a pupil of Freud and Jung, who studied Indian philosophy and then developed a system of his own which he would call transpersonal psychology. And here he calls the part that is above the waterline the conscious, the part that is below the waterline the lower unconscious, and the so-called seabed as the higher unconscious, which was the seed of such things as imagination, peak experiences. He defined peak experiences as experiences of unity and joy which transcended the individual sense of themselves as a separate unit. Meditation practice and the unconscious. Now, this is a personal view. I believe that as one tries to work through one's stuff, the place of healing is outside one's personal stuff. Everybody has personal stuff. But if you get stuck inside of it, you come out worse rather than better. But the place of healing is to come out of oneself, to come out of any sense of self-importance. And I have the belief that why should God help me when he doesn't help someone else? Why do I deserve any kind of special merit? And based on this, I do believe that if one comes to a point of what one shares with everyone else, then this is the place of greater healing, and it's the place to try to be. Past life therapy. This is the work of Dr. Brian Weiss and others in the field. Now, this is a strange story because Dr. Weiss is a graduate of Columbia University and Yale. And he was the former chairman of psychiatry at Mount Sinai Medical Center, Miami. He stumbled upon past life therapy, as it were, by mistake. He wrote a book about this, Many Lives, Many Masters, which was published in 1988, and I understand has sold around 2 million copies. It is extraordinary. When I first came across it, it literally blew my mind away. He was trying to help a patient of his with hypnosis in the 1980s, when this poor patient started to speak of other things that had happened in other lives, and he couldn't understand it. And the experience was so startling that it changed the life of both the patient and Dr. Weiss. From then on, Dr. Weiss began to research the idea that through hypnosis, one could find out about matters to do with the beyond. And in his latest book called Same Soul, Many Bodies, he describes the results of 25 years of work in this subject, and for him, reincarnation is actually a fact. And he describes why he says that it is a fact. And I believe that this is one of the most, or perhaps the most important medical discovery to date. During past life regression using hypnosis, people often come up with strange stories, so I gather from the literature. Now, are these stories a fabrication to suit the client's fantasy? Are they a fabrication to pander to the therapist's wishes? Are there alternative explanations? And is the story compatible with the client's previous knowledge? And it raises other questions of this sort. Dr. Weiss has also come across people that, under hypnosis, start to speak a different language, one that they could never have known, and this defies explanation. What is interesting about past life regression stories is that most of the work has been done in America, and most of the work since the 1980s has actually been recorded on cassette tape, and many of these people that have undergone this therapy are still alive and can be interviewed. I think this is ideal material for scientific researchers that can have open minds, rather like studying the X-Files. Now, if evidence for past lives is found to be with foundation, I think the implications are just staggering. And this will amount to the biggest scientific breakthrough of the century. Well, it won't happen this century, but might happen in the next century, but it's still an extraordinary thing. One has to remember that science deals with what is true and with what works.